I think we can start. Good evening, everyone. My name is Chiara Cocchiara, and I welcome you on behalf of the Space Economy Academy to this webinar about the new trends and challenges in the GNSS systems. So this webinar will be an introduction about the GNSS systems and the key elements that characterize these systems. And then, as some of you know, because I can see someone from the participant list that is already an alumni from the Space Economy Academy, this is an introduction to the more technical course that we have in our platform. So with this, I would like to welcome, first of all, our speaker, Gerarda De Pasquale. She will properly introduce herself, but allow me to say a couple of words. She is a lecturer at the Space Economy Academy, and she works for REA Group. She's based at the EUSPA. I would like to say also a couple of words about the logistics of this webinar. I would like to ask each of you to keep mute while the lecturers speak, also in a way that everyone can listen without issues. But on the other end, I also welcome you to interact. So if you have specific questions, then you can always either raise your hand and then we will take your question, or you can write in the chat so that we can read and we can answer. And otherwise, you can also ask towards the end. So with this, I leave the word to Gerarda, and I hope you will enjoy.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Claudia. And I hope that you can hear me very well. And welcome to this webinar on the new trends and challenges in GNSS system. I am Gerarda De Pasquale, and I will be your speaker for this webinar. I have several years experience in satellite navigation system, and I specialize in particular on the user segment part. Since my university degree, I had this passion about the space segment, the space topics, and in particular about the GNSS topics. This is why I decided then to work for the GNSS industry. I also support the system engineering team in Galileo Force Generation Unit at ESA ESTEC. And now actually I'm a consultant at EUSPA, the European Union Agency for the Space Program, and I support the activity related to the European Space Program Evolution. Due to my passion for space, I decided to broaden my knowledge from the technical topics to more business and economic topics related to the space sector. And I attended two courses, the certificate, and I got two certificates, one in the space economy with the Space Economy Academy, and a certificate in space for business. So now going directly on the key point and the key aspect of this webinar. And what I would like to present to you with, to show you with this webinar is to define the GNSS system. So to show most of all what is the importance of a global navigation satellite system, where they are used and why they're the GNSS system are continues to evolve and to grow. And also, most of all, the last but not least key point is we will cover the evolution of the GNSS and the market trends. So GNSS service are indeed the backbone of position navigation time service. GNSS means Global Navigation Satellite Service, and provide absolute position navigation time with unprecedented level of accuracy, with global coverage at any time, and also with reasonable low infrastructure costs. This is why they are seen as the backbone of position navigation and timing service. In the last year and in the coming years, it's expected that the socioeconomic benefit provided by GNSS reached 2 trillion euros. Indeed, GNSS can improve our daily life in several different kinds of applications and services. And therefore, more than 100,000 higher skilled jobs attributed to GNSS industry were created. So it represents not only an important service that we can rely on to improve our daily life, but can provide also opportunity in the work sector. So for the GNSS in particular industry. GNSS indeed is used in many critical infrastructure as for example, in space application, in transportation, air traffic control, for shipping operation, energy service, vehicle tracking. So the market segment in which GNSS is used is really broad. And with the advent of a new wave of service and business, its central role is increasing. But this is why one of the key points that GNSS is continues to evolve. So to serve this new wave of service and business. Market segment, many people only refer to GNSS system to GPS system instead of GNSS. While GPS is just only one of the several global navigation satellite systems that are available nowadays, and it is the American GNSS. So what is in GNSS? So what we are referring when we use the word GNSS? GNSS, as I said before, it means a global satellite navigation system, and they refer to a constellation of satellites provide the signal from space that transmit position and time data to GNSS receiver. And these data are used by the GNSS receiver to estimate the location and the time of the user. So then going in particular more in detail on how the receiver computes its own position, this is addressed estimating the time of arrival of the signal broadcast by the satellite. So since the receiver knows the position of the satellite and knows the time on which the satellite transmits the signal, he can then compute the transit time of the signal, and using all this information, it can derive its own location. But one of the important key aspects that we need to underline is that this is possible since the clock on board the satellite is perfectly synchronized to an internal system time scale. The satellite indeed rely on the use of a rubidium clock. Unfortunately, the clock instead used by the GNSS receiver are not so perfect and are not synchronized with the time scale of the satellite time scale, since the rubidium clocks are really expensive. And so this is why we cannot afford to use this kind of clock on board the receiver. So instead to compute the position of the user, so the X, Y, and Z coordinate of the user, we need also to compute and estimate an additional known, that is the clock synchronization bias of the user with respect to GNSS time scale. And to do so, we need then, therefore, to rely on at least 4 satellites to estimate these 4 unknown. When, for example, we use just one GNSS system, in the case instead we use more than one GNSS system at the same time, we have to add to our system of equation an unknown for each GNSS system that we use in our equation due to the time difference between the different GNSS system. So for example, GPS system, GPS satellite are synchronized with the GPS time, while Galileo satellite are synchronized with the Galileo time. So we need to estimate also in our equation the difference between the two the time scale, between the GPS time scale and the Galileo time scale. So nowadays we have six different GNSS system that we can use to compute our position at the same time. We have four GNSS system that provide global coverage, and our GPS, that is the American GPS system, Galileo, that is the European GNSS system, GLONASS and BeiDou. And then we have also two additional GNSS system that instead provide only regional coverage, that are the India GNSS system and the Japanese GNSS system. Regarding instead the architecture of the GNSS system, we can describe and define the GNSS architecture, dividing this, identify the architecture in three different blocks, in three different segments. The space segment, the master, the control segment, the ground segment, also called the ground segment, and the user segment. The space segment, it includes the constellation of the satellite that orbit in the main orbit. So there are they orbit about 20,000 kilometers above the Earth. And this is this orbit is very suitable for this kind of service, since just with 24 or 36 satellites are needed to have a global coverage. So in each point of the Earth is possible to see at least for satellite. And these are the satellites, therefore, that are needed to compute our position estimation. Each satellite transmits a unique PRN code, a unique signal that can be detected by the receiver. The receiver can demodulate this signal, so can retrieve the data information provided by the satellite. And therefore, using the navigation data, and also computing the time of arrival of the signal, he can then compute its estimate its own position. Regarding instead the control segment, it includes the monitoring station, master control station, and the ground antenna. The monitoring station receives the GNSS signal in space and send this information to the master control station. The task to compute the navigation data, to generate command and telemetry, and also to perform some check performance of the satellite, so to assess the health status of the satellite. All the information that the satellite has to send to the receiver are generated by the master control station that are sent to the ground antenna that have the task to upload this information to the satellite. And also there are some telemetry and telemetry station that instead have the task to control the satellite and the position of the satellite, so to send some command and telemetry commands to the satellite. The user equipment segment instead include all the GNSS receiver that use the GNSS signal. The basic function of a GNSS receiver is to collect and distinguish the signal in space transmitted by the satellite, to measure the pseudo range, so the pseudo distance of each received signal, to demodulate the navigation message, and then finally to estimate the position of velocity with the time. In this figure, you can see the main building block of a GNSS receiver, and it's basically made by an antenna that receives the radio frequency signal of the satellite, a front end that converts this analog signal in digital AF signal, and then this digital AF signal can be used inside the receiver by the acquisition stage, tracking stage, and the navigation stage that can perform the computation of the position, velocity, and time. Unfortunately, the job of a GNSS receiver is not so easy. Indeed, the signal in space transmitted by the satellite are affected by several errors. And these errors depend on several aspects. The satellite position and the satellite clock, unfortunately, is not known with high accuracy. They are affected by some error. And luckily, this error is estimated by the monitoring control station, and then is transmitted inside the navigation message. Then we have also the kind of error. For example, the signal are affected by the Doppler effect due to the different velocity of the satellite with respect to the receiver. And the signal transmitted by the satellite, unfortunately, doesn't have an higher power due to the distance of the satellite with respect to the receiver. And it's also affected by other atmospheric error, as for example, the ionosphere and the troposphere. Then there are also other additional errors that impact the signal that are related instead to the environment, as for example the multipath, the urban canyons, and the multipath and the obstruction of the signal due to, for example, some building or when, for example, we are inside a building. And then, unfortunately, the signal is also affected by both unintentional and intentional interference, jamming, and spoofing. It's possible to mitigate this kind of error using algorithms, different kind of algorithms, and also relying on the correction provided by other services. But the use of this algorithm to mitigate this error unfortunately impacts the performance of the receiver, some other KPI parameter of the receiver. For example, they affect the the time to force fix, and also the power consumption of the receiver, while instead they can improve the accuracy provided by the receiver. So what the receiver then they do is based on the target application, they apply the algorithm that are more suitable and then respect the requirement needed by the kind of the application that the user want to rely on. So on the market, we have different kind of receiver and can be mainly grouped in four different group: the mass market receiver, the safety and reliability critical device, the high accuracy device, and the timing device. The mass market device are mainly used for IoT application, for no safety critical application in the smartphone, and also in augmented reality. This kind of device, they target an accuracy that is not so high. So they don't need to provide an high accuracy. Indeed, the accuracy is just in the order of some meter. But what is important is that this kind of device target a low power consumption and a low time to force fix. The safety and reliability critical device instead are the devices used for safety applications, safety critical application, as for example in aviation or for professional drones, in automotive sector, in the maritime sector, search and rescue. This kind of device, they need high integrity and high robustness, while the accuracy is not a key priority. And to provide this kind of high integrity and high robustness, and also so therefore to be used in this safety or critical application, they need to be built in a contract with a specific standard, so to deliver the application that they are targeting. Then we had said high accuracy device that are used by the application that need the highest accuracy possible. So indeed they target an accuracy in the order of a centimeter or even less. And the availability also is a key parameter that they have to provide. While the time to force fix is not so important, is not a priority as for example the mass market device. And instead, indeed, for this kind of application, since the accuracy has to be in the order of a centimeter, then we will need a conference time also for some minutes to reach this kind of accuracy. This kind of application are are mainly used in the agriculture sector, in the geodesy and survival application. The timing device can also be categorized as a high accuracy device, since also this kind of device, they provide high accuracy. In this case, this kind of device provide high time accuracy in the order of nanoseconds. They are mainly used for time synchronization solution, as for example, telecom, energy, finance, and transport application. And for this reason, the higher priority is the traceability and the robustness and the resilience. Even if, anyway, we have already nowadays several GNSS receivers on the market, and they can provide different kind of application, the GNSS receiver and also the GNSS itself continues to evolve. And what is then the driver of this evolution? So why the GNSS receiver continues to evolve, even if they are already well established on the market? The driver of this evolution are the user needs. So nowadays we are changing our lives based on the, for example, the digital evolution, or the new challenges that impact our lives, as for example, the pandemic and the climate change. Therefore, we need to rely on different applications that are characterized by some requirements that are completely different to the requirement that instead we rely on in several years ago. So for example, nowadays we need more green solution, we will need to rely on applications that are more safety, and there are different new challenges, for example, spoofing challenge or cyber security attack that can affect the application that we use. And we need to evolve the algorithm used by the receiver to mitigate this kind of effect. Then, as well as also the service to satisfy the user needs, need to provide different new service. As for example, the upcoming authentication service that will be provided by Galileo System. And so one of the key important aspects is that GNSS can be not seen just as a localization service. So it can be used in different kind of market segment. And it is also a key business opportunity for the industry, the space industry. And most of all, the what we would need to think about to provide, so to support the different user needs and also to support the economy and the growth of the industry and the general SaaS industry, so that doesn't exist one unique solution for all the user needs, but we can provide different kind of solution, different application, different service to support what the user requires. So then now going a bit more on the application, what we are facing nowadays is that the society our society and our economy is impacted by new aspects, by new challenges, as for example the digital revolution, climate change, and the global pandemics. And therefore, the application that are coming nowadays are applications, for example, autonomous car or autonomous transportation that are more safety and also more green solution. But also we are going to rely more on the use of drones and robots, on the use of Internet of Things to improve our daily life. And also we are relying more and more on new emerging warning service that helps to save life better anyway of the service that we use in the past. So let's go now a bit more in detail of this different kind of segment and where then Genesis can be used in to serve the new market segment, the new trends of the market segment. Genesis is used in agriculture, for precise agriculture, and also because it represents a key service to support the environment sustainability and the economic variability. Nowadays, the need to track food from source to consumer is increasing. We will need to, for example, what the user needs nowadays is to have food with higher quality and also to not waste food, so to have a green solution. And this can be made also using GNSS in the agriculture. Then GNSS can be also used in aviation and drones. And it will be most of all used in the future and also nowadays to reduce the impact that the aviation, the high drones have on the environment. So it can be used to reduce the fuel consumption and also to optimize the path of the drones and optimize the path of the airplane. GNSS is also a key service in the biodiversity ecosystem, natural capital, climate service. It can be used to track the animals, to study the behavior of the animals, and also to monitor the climate change together with the Earth conservation. Then instead of going to the consumer solution, tourism and health, and health service, we are seeing nowadays that our lives is impacted by the COVID-19, and we need to improve our daily life, and we also rely for this reason on online shopping or, for example, online billing and other kind of online purchase. And for this kind of application, GNSS is key. And in particular, it's key also to monitor, for example, the distance between the people and also to trace the contacts. One of the applications related to this was, for example, the use of robots to trace and to determine the distance between the people. GNSS is becoming a trend also in emerging management and humanitarian aid. And we have seen, for example, the upcoming launch of the search and rescue service by the Galileo system. And it helps therefore to save lives and in a better way anyway with respect to the service that we use in the past. And it's also used, for example, to coordinate emergency response and humanitarian aid. Regarding instead the energy and the raw material and the infrastructure, the Genostas is used to optimize the maintenance of the infrastructure and also to optimize the construction of the infrastructure. So, for example, as is shown in this figure, is used to help the guidance of the machine during the building, during the construction of a building. Then we have other three different sector market segment in which Genostas play a key role. And are the insurance and financial segment in which Genostas, for example, is used to in the insurance using, for example, drones for a more accurate and faster claim assessment. And it's also used as a source of time to synchronize the financial transaction and to test them also the financial transaction. Genostas play a clear role in all kinds of autonomous transportation to enable more full efficiency and safer navigation of the maritime vessel, to increase safety and reduce the cost of rail infrastructure, and also to provide more sustainable transport in urban environment with autonomous vehicle. And it's become also a trend in the use of the space segment, and in particular if we think about the lunar mission. And to serve, therefore, to support this mission, then of course it's needed also to have navigation service, so to estimate our position or the position of the machine also on the moon. So then the application are evolving, and we need to serve all these kinds of different application and service. Also the Genostas receiver has to evolve. And based on the application, the evolution of the Genostas receiver is different. For example, for the IoT application, we will need smaller receiver, cheaper, more powerful, and less power hungry receiver. In case instead of high accuracy, or instead of application that required high accuracy, we will need that the receiver shall use an higher number of signal and also frequency, and then shall also need to use other kind of correction provided by other service. Then to support the application that need robustness against spoofing, the receiver shall implement also authentication mechanism and therefore for this kind of application, they can use, for example, the Galileo SNMA service that start to be provided now by Galileo system. Then for the safety of critical application, the Genostas receiver needs to implement integrity mechanism, and this can be done through to the use of augmentation system. And then to serve IoT applications, smart application, and also kind of augmented reality that needs device to rely on devices with low power consumption and also with a more accurate solution. One of the trends is to use a cloud-based snapshot and Abris solution inside the Genostas receiver. So now let's go more on the statistics, so on the number. Let's see how the revenue of the Genostas device is affecting the economy of the Genostas industry, And how many GNSS receiver shipment we are seeing nowadays, and how many we will expect in the future. So as I said before, science GNSS is play a vital role and provide different innovative solution for those and our application. The GNSS receiver shipment is expected to grow, and from 2021, so we had GNSS receiver shipment of around 1.8 billion. And we will see that in the future, in 2031, that this number is expected to grow and to reach 2.5 billion. So indeed, the GNSS market is significantly expanded both in terms of device and service. Regarding instead to the revenue, we will see then that instead the revenue will almost double, in particular for the revenue related to the added value service. And this revenue are coming most of all from the consumer solution, tourism and health application. But a significant contribution is also given by the road and the automotive sector that contribute to the revenue by around the 30% of the total revenue. So going to the conclusion, what we have seen in this webinar is that the Global Navigation Satellite System provides a precise level of accuracy for position with global coverage at any time and with reasonable low infrastructure cost, and provides absolute position. This is why it's preferred with respect to other kind of service, for example, a system that rely, for example, on inertial sensor that instead provide a relative positioning. GNSS is used in a wide range of service to the population, industry, and government organization for many years, and is expected to play a primary role in the new year of application to appear in the coming years. And the market drives the development of the receiver, the system itself. So the evolution of the GNSS receiver and GNSS system depends by the user needs. So which are the requirements of the new application that we are using nowadays and that we will use in the future. So since sector, the GNSS sector, is continues to evolve, the demand of technicians with radio navigation knowledge is increasing enormously. And you can therefore get more knowledge, so become an expert on GNSS system and serve the GNSS world. And to do this, you can, for example, participate to our GNSS course offered by SEAC Business School, Business Academy, that include different kind of technical aspect related to the GNSS system. And so not only we will cover what we have already seen in this webinar, but we will touch a bit more in detail all the technical aspect related to the GNSS system and the GNSS receiver. We will see more in detail the GNSS architecture, how the GNSS receiver works, the building blocks of a GNSS receiver, the function and the algorithm used by the GNSS receiver. And last but not least, there will be also a section that covers the augmentation system. So thank you everyone anyway to participate to this webinar. And if you have any question, feel free to raise your doubts or your question. And otherwise I will give the floor to Chiara Cocchiara.
Thank you, Gerard. It was really interesting, and it was very difficult to condense so much information in such a short period of time. So I hope that the audience have enjoyed and that you captured the main elements of the GNSS systems, the architecture, and also the new trends and challenges that we have with this respect. So as Gerarda said, of course, this is an extract from the main course. I have sent in, I will send in the chat the link to our main course. And there you can check the details once again, and you can learn even more about that. If you have any questions, I would invite you to tell us, to either you can write or you can directly speak up. And otherwise, you can also contact us via email. So actually, I can see that there is a question from Rachita. So she's asking, maybe Gerard, I read it for you. According to you, how far the involvement of commercial enterprise can affect benefits of GNSS.
So indeed, this everything as I present in this this slide depends on the kind of application that the industry wants to provide. So there are several services, several applications that we will see in the future that the user wants to use. And for this kind of application, then the enterprise can anyway look for and can therefore to invest on it. For example, we are seeing nowadays that the key trend is the use of autonomous transportation. And for this kind of transportation, GNSS is play a critical, really a critical role, since it provides position with safety and integrity. So with high safety and integrity, that is important for this kind of autonomous transportation, which the, for example, the life of the people can be in danger.
Many thanks, Gerarda. I hope that this answer the question of Rachita. Yes, I can see. Thank you.
Okay, thanks a lot.
Very good. Are there any further questions that you want to ask to Gerarda? So I can see Adriano brought another question. Are there any limitations for current GNSS systems receivers that you think will be solved in the coming years?
Yes, there are several unfortunately limitations, in particular the limitation of the use of GNSS receiver in urban environment or in indoor. And for this kind of scenario, then we need to rely not only on GNSS system, but we need also to rely on other kind of service, other kind of sensor. So it's key to provide a solution that can combine not only GNSS, but also their sensor. And one of the trends to face anyway this challenge of to have the global coverage of the GNSS signal inside also in urban environment is, for example, the use also of a LEO signal, that which the characteristic of the signal provided by the LEO is different from the one provided by the GEO signal, and combine LEO signal or using the LEO satellite for positioning, then we can have so better solution also in case of urban environment or in indoor position. And for the case of indoor position, it's key also to use GNSS together with inertial sensor.
Perfect, thank you. Are there any more questions that you want to ask? Yes, I can see Davide. What is the OSMA added value or differences with respect to the PRS? which is already an authenticated service.
Okay, so one of the key aspects on this, or key point that is important to mention, is that OSNMA is, as it says the name, is an open service. So can be used by all the receiver. While PRS is a restricted service, is not public, so can be used only by authorized receiver. And they provide a different kind of service. So SNMA is an authenticated service and authenticate the navigation message provided by the Galileo signal, and is open, while the PRS is only used by, for example, military receiver, and is not, so as I said before, is not public.
Very well, thank you. Are there any further questions? Otherwise, I also wanted to share with you that we have a promotional code. You can see it on the screen, and it's Starship. So you can use it to get a 20% discount in the course. That's because you attended the webinar. So are there further questions? No, then thank you once again to our lecturer, and I wish you all a nice evening. You will find the recordings available. We will upload to YouTube, so you can also look at the webinar once again if you want to check some details. Thank you, and see you the next time. We have another webinar on the 24th of May about space economy, so you can register via LinkedIn once again. Bye-bye.
Thank you. Thank you, everyone. Bye.